I know that for some years I was looking for a way to tell about the two dimensions of our life in Israel. One is the most private one, the intimate level of a family. And I'm fascinated by families in all structures. And the other dimension was an attempt to write about what we call the situation, hamatzav, which is a very strange word that is another example of how language is being whitewashed, so we should not feel the extremity, the acuteness of the situation. In Hebrew, hamatzav, the situation, it refers to something that is, you know, given from heaven. You know, there is something stable, yatziv. You can even hear the alliteration, hamatzav yatziv. The situation is stable. And when you say hamatzav, it is as if no one has actually created it. It was given. And I tried to find ways to interweave these two levels. And for years I was unable to do it. I was very active politically and I wrote essays, but I felt that I do not have the language, the intimate language to talk about the situation. That everything I said sounded to me like a cliché. Someone has said it before, I said it before, many others have said it before. And only when I had this idea of a woman who suddenly decides to turn her back on the situation, not to collaborate with the situation. We all collaborate with the situation. We collaborate in ways of despair, of apathy or aggression, but we collaborate. We are part of it. And Ora, after she brings her son to the gathering point of the army, he goes there to a military operation, and she comes back home, and she starts to wait for the notifiers who will come and knock on her door to tell her the bad news about her son. And in Israel, there is a very developed machinery of notification. They will come and knock on your door at any hour of the day or the night when they got the confirmation for the fact. And until this moment, she's a typical Israeli woman, or a typical Israeli. You know, she did what she is programmed to do. She took her son, she drove him to the gathering point, she said hello to him, she came back home and waited. But suddenly she asks herself, what if I'm not there to receive the bad news? She understands that it takes two for bad news, one to deliver and one to receive. What if I'm not there to receive? Maybe the whole machinery of the message, of the notification, will be reversed for what, a day, an hour, even a minute in such situation is very, I mean, it means. And she runs away from home, and by so doing, as if she uprooted herself from the situation, reformulated the situation, suddenly she's not a victim of this situation. And it is something that, even for me, writing here was new. What does it mean that I do not collaborate with the situation? It is so irresponsible not to sit and to wait for the notifiers. But there was also something liberating in that, you know, that she rewrites the story and she escapes, but for me it's not an escapist book or story. Because she does something very active, she tells the life story of her son to the man with whom she runs away, the man she almost kidnaps. Avram was the love of her life and the love of her youth, and he has all kind of connection with Ofer that we should not, with the son in the army that we should not elaborate now. And she feels that by telling the story, the little stories of the upbringing of Ofer, she protects him, as if she infuses life and strength to him that will protect him when he's out there in the world.
When you started this book, do you also saw this book as a kind of protection that you could give to your own children, like a talisman or like Joan Didion, who had this, what she called the magical thinking? Do you think that writing has this power?
Stories are not bulletproof, unfortunately. I started writing it just before our second son, Uri, went to the army. I think his going to the army was for me a very strong incentive to be able to write the book, because I felt I want to accompany him, I want to be with him as much as I can. I knew from the beginning he is going to serve in the occupied territories. I knew he's going to face harsh reality. I felt at least a need to be with him as much as I can. Being his father, but belonging to the generation who, in a way, created this catastrophe of the occupation, catastrophe of the situation, and also being unable to change anything in spite of the things I tried to do for years now, for decades, I can say, I felt that at least I can accompany him, be with him, through the telling of the story. Of course, like any parent, any father, I had this magical belief, you know. I knew it's not rational, but we all have our little bargains with the God or with the devil or with destiny and fate, whatever. We do all these little tricks. And I did what I could. That's what I can say.
Thank you for the synopsis you gave us of the book just a moment ago. But these two ideas of, on one side, the journey of the mother, and other side, this kind of suspense, as if she was obliged to tell the story of her son to her friend, as Scheherazade had to tell stories to the master every night, just not to be killed, if it's not about her own death, but another death. Are perhaps explanations why we have the impression reading the book that it is a kind of archetype, that you return to two fundamental themes, that of the Odyssey, in a certain way, the journey of Ulysses, but in your own country, which is in the world in itself, and otherwise, the way this woman tries to not exactly escape, as you say, but trying not to be the one who will receive the announcement.
There are all kinds of myths, I think, interwoven into this story. And I prefer to leave it to the critics, actually. I'm not sure that I'm the one who should indicate these things. For me, it's a very domestic epos. And what interested me are really the most concrete and intimate layers of a family, because every family is a little myth, a mythology. Every family has its own memories and legends and vocabulary, even. I always think, you know, that really the greatest moments in the history of mankind, they have not occurred in battlefields or parliaments or palaces, but rather in kitchens and in bedrooms and in rooms of children.